My name is Elizabeth Streb, and the first time I saw Merce's work was in the late 70s, early 80s. And I went to BAM, I believe, or even maybe it was Nazareth College up in Rochester. I can't quite remember where it was. It was on a proscenium stage. And it was when I realized that was a technique I wanted to study, that was the only rigor, in my opinion, then it was the only rigorous technique that modern dance had to offer, and it was one of the things I was so distraught in terms of studying modern dance was how unintellectual it was. And I think it had to do with rhythms, because I think in temporality, rhythmic issues are where the deep intelligence lies. Otherwise, you're learning techniques and you're figuring out how to get your hips and socket and your knees stretched and all of that. But the rhythms were very mundane. And with Merce, that was not true. And I studied with Merce, but only a little. I mostly trained with Viola Farber once I got to New York. And her rhythms were mighty and confusing and completely compelling. So watching Merce, watching his choreography made me realize there's a deep, great brain at work in my time, and I was very excited and moved.
When did he first see you?
Well, of course, I have that memorized exactly. It was in February 1981. Well, no. I guess he first saw me when I still lived in California. Merce Cunningham first saw me, my person, when I was a very young dancer. And I was living in San Francisco because I drove my motorcycle across country, and that's where I landed. And I was studying with Margie Jenkins because she was teaching Cunningham technique. And I was there from 72 to 74. And in 73, in the summer, I went down to Long Beach, as did every reasonable dancer on the West Coast, to take a workshop with Merce Cunningham and Sandra Neils. And that's when I first saw him face to face, hung on every word. I remember almost everything that he said then, that dance is like life, and that you look out at life, and that's dance. And that was his laboratory, the world. And I was so moved. I hung on every word. I went home and wrote it down, and I think I still practice that. Pay attention. That was the other thing he said during that workshop, you pay attention, you maintain interest. And I think this dance we were doing was a very, very fast dance. And he said something that I keep quoting and thinking about myself, that you don't develop taste or fondness for anything in particular. For instance, you don't say, oh, I can't do that, or I can't do this. When things go very, very fast, you go, I can't move that quickly. You develop an appetite for everything you think you either can't do or don't want to do. Your job as an artist is to develop an appetite to acquire the skill to do that. And that's the only way your range and your language ability expands.
And how have you done that?
Well, it's a surprisingly how I've attempted to incorporate that rubric into my practice is it's a surprisingly simple yet complex exercise to pay attention like that. And I think that I examine movement in the world wherever I might be, walking around. And one of the practices I've done to try and take note of what's happening around me is to look up, you know, places where you don't ordinarily, if you're in a hurry, you don't look up, look over, look down, and just glance around the world as you're walking through it. And it's incredible and alarming how many small treasures you collect, like dust storms or wind, or the way little kids frolic in leaf piles or twigs or stones, the way adults are kind of tugging them along. So I watch children and how they behave in the world, and I think that I've asked certain questions about movement, but my observational skills are, I don't think, as apt as Merce's are. I aspire to that, his observational skills are holy almost, like this. He's as clear as a winter sky on the coldest night of the year. He's unsentimental. I mean, I think that to gaze out the way he does, or the way I imagine he does, you can't be sentimental or engage in acts of regret or hope. And I see him as being an avid watcher, not personally attached to assessing what he's seeing and making a comment on it, but he sees it purely, that therefore. And it's not that he's obviously cold, right? He sees life as on life's terms and movement on movement's terms. And I've really been attracted to the fact that his work is true. You know, it's not the kind of, I mean, it's actual, because he cannot tell a lie. He's incapable of it, even when he talks. He just says what is true. And I can't imagine him ever being, or I can't imagine Merce ever doing anything but that, but he must have been a kid one time. He must have been a young, crazy adult one time. So I attribute his sincerity, actualness, and assiduousness and brilliance to his practice and how he's learned to look at the world.
On the surface, your work would seem to be entirely different from his. Are some of your concerns the same?
Well, our work, if a stranger walked in a room and saw both of our work at separate moments, you would say there was no connection whatsoever, I imagine. But I think that the result of one's questions are sometimes radically divergent from the questions themselves. And I think those results, the implementation of questions and the collection of data and how you might take that data and implement it for a theatrical moment, which is, in all admission, an artificial moment. Once you're on stage, that's an artificial zone. And the way I implement my collection of data versus the way Merce implements his collection of data, and this is not at all to compare them, because I'm so far away from that right now in my work. But my definition of real is different, and my definition of what would authentic action impose on an audience or impose on a body couldn't be more different, I don't think. I don't believe in standing right side up. I don't really believe in using only the bottoms of your feet as base, predominantly base of support. I don't really believe in skeletal locomotive movement. I also include one thing that I know that by default Merce does, but I do as initiator of a lot of the movement, and that's issues of force, the engagement of an exaggeration of force as invisible forces that govern action in a Newtonian sense. I believe that I'm trying to expose those forces, as although they are invisible, as palpable experiences for the audience. And we hurl our bodies, we fly. And I think that certainly Merce has his version of flying, but because of all those things, and because of my questions, the non-camouflage of gravity, the exposition of effort, the belief that if you end a move 5 feet in the air, you do nothing after that moment, you just let a bunch of things happen, which include crashing to the ground, landing, and all of the complexity involved in that moment.
Those are all negative things, what you don't have in common. What do you have in common?
I think that one of the ideas that Merce and I may share together is that he believes that you do the move, and only that move in that moment, in that present tense moment, and you don't do anything unnecessary. There's no decoration in Merce's work. And he would say that if he sees unnecessary moves or decorative moves, which I consider to be extra essential, in other words, non-essential movements, he will remove them once he notices them. I 100% agree that to get from here to there, there's a very articulated set of moves you're doing, no more, no less, and it's completely functional to get from here to there. I 100% concur and agree with that. I think it has to do with what is an essential move, you know, and it has to do with not necessarily what you're doing, but how you're doing it. And I think the how part, all of those adverbs, like how, cannot be separated from the temporal integrity that Merce Cunningham employs when he's choreographing. And I think his attention and use of time in his movement invention is unparalleled. And this is what I believe should be annotated in a whole new language. You know, the way they figure out iambic pentameter for poetry, or the way they figure out all these complicated namings of the use of music. Like Merce's temporality, because it is not musical, is unique unto itself. And that is inflicted on the body as they do that essentialist move from here to there.
He says rhythm is time cut up.
Well, rhythm, if Merce says that rhythm is time cut up, I think you'd have to first, for me, you would have to first decide that is there time? Is time real? Well, many scientists we are dealing with time, you know, but it doesn't, but there's a lot of controversy about the arrow of time. And it's definitely a device. You can't say a sentence without some sort of duration. But if time is cut up, I mean, isn't it true, John Wheeler would say, that time is the universe's way of keeping everything from happening at once? That's what many scientists would say. But that's to imply it's a device. It's not real. And I think that the cutting up of time is, again, a beautiful Mercean way to describe the sort of paltry grab that humans have on manipulating time at all. I believe that I never set up a temporal structure. I think timing as an idea in movement is an emergent factor, that first you find your place in space, and then it's always unhabitual in Streb world. And then once you get there in that unhabitual place in space, usually with the assistance of a mechanical device, then you assess and develop what the vocabulary is, which is the physical part, the body part. And then after doing that maybe 100 times, out of that emerges what the rhythm or the timing for that piece is.
Like Merce's work, yours is non-narrative, yet people find stories or meaning or symbolism in it, as they do with his. I would be the worst offender. How do you feel about people finding those things in your work?
Well, yes, I think the work that Streb presents is non-narrative. I think that's leaning into a more literal, literature-based, text-based, maybe emotionally-based set of interpretations. And I think that our actions are constructed to evoke an experience from the audience. And a physical experience is my goal. And certainly I think of myself as an anthropologist in a way. I'm collecting archetypal actions that I think, if I can present them, will be recognizable, almost metaphorically, to the humans perceiving them. So there's no way I can usurp from that human their narrative interpretation of what I'm doing. And in fact, as long as I don't intend it or impose my own emotional, sentimental narrative on what we're doing. I don't believe you can do that. It's impossible, in my opinion. But there's no way you can't, there's no way that I can stop a audience member from inflicting that on their experience of the work.
It amazes me to hear you call the stage an artificial place. It's the first time I've ever heard you use the word artificial in relation to something you do. When did you come to recognize this grim fact, and why is it artificial? It's people. How can it be artificial? It's a real space with real people in it. Is it because it's planned ahead?
Well, great. Well, yes, it's a real space. The theater, the stage, is a real space with real people. But it's almost in a meta way that's true. It's not true isolated, rabid space. It's a controlled environment. And planning action ahead is the behavior that stabs it in the gut. So really, what I'm trying to present is a series of causal events that if you tried to stop them, you'd get hurt. So in a certain way, it's an accident scene. I'm attempting to make things so non-predictive that, yes, they're planned, but if they appear planned, it would be an artificial activity. And so within the confines of what I see as an extracted hunk of space that is a domain that receives pre-planned performances, which for me, by virtue of that, makes it artificial. Onto that, I try and layer a madhouse of chaotic and crazy acts that the audience will be alarmed by. I've often said that my job is to keep the audience's attention. How do I do that? Partially by scaring them, partially by defying reason within our attendant acts as they progress.
It's exactly the job of a writer, you know, to keep the person reading.
Well, what's action's version of a page turner? Exactly. Especially when they can get up and walk out or put the book down.
Same problem.
It's the same problem. And how do you do that? You know, I think it's just so... I mean, I think the other thing I was going to say about Merce, because I was thinking about rhythm. We're talking about rhythm. And rhythm is time cut up, if that's true. I think rhythm is, if it's profound rhythm, it grabs the body by the gut and the heart and circumvents the brain. So that kind of attention getting, which is what I think Merce's work does, is a type of thing that, for instance, Le Corbusier used to talk about. Is there such a thing as an idea of spatial harmonics? Could we develop kind of a lexicon of spatial harmonics the way music and math went together? They were so inextricably bound, and they technically figured out not just a nomenclature for both, but a way that they intersected in terms of each of those disciplines. And I think Le Corbusier, although he had terrible histories of being responsible for the Radiant City and all this other stuff that was terrible, I think that he really had an idea, and he talked about the scale in Modular 1 and Modular 2. He talked about the scale of the human body, and I know he constructed rooms to attend to. Well, how big is the body? And he talked about proportion and the golden mean, and I think that within the notion of Merce, yes, he's right side up. Yes, his base is mostly the bottoms of the feet. Yes, he's dancing, not in the way musical people dance, but in the way brilliant temporal geniuses dance. And he's piercing the space with his the bodies of his dancers. He's piercing the space with these spatial interrupters. And if you think of his visual spatial compilations, he's reinventing how space gets divided by how he's instructing his dancers to move in time.
Would biped be an example of that?
I think biped would definitely be an example of that. He used motion capture, and he was, I think, one of the first choreographers to put on stage the notion of 3D dance. Because our problem with presenting dance has been legion, I think. They've not solved the issue that proscenium flattens out what the dancer is trying to stretch. And in Biped, he completely solved that problem of being in more than one place at the same time, which bodies have to do to, as an information system, it's a digital information system. And so that's exactly what bodies have to do, to be in more than one place at the same time, or at least appear to be. And the notion of how he choreographs, and I think he was using life forms at that point for his choreography, he did non-intuitive sets of choices and strung them together and not forced, but required the dancers to learn these kind of non-comfortable sets of behaviors on stage. And what it did was bring alarm to the audience and get us to notice what is usually ordinary and normal. You know, this is how you use your arms. Well, no, not in Biped. This is how you use your legs. This is how your torso relates to your trunk or your legs. That's not what happened. So because of the way that Merce defamiliarized our watching of the human body in Biped and its presentation with the motion capture, blew the notion of presentation of action kind of off the planet Earth. What makes a artificial safe zone, cordoned off space, rabid, unsafe, dangerous, is that you're attempting to construct and generate forces within it that will not offer a safe place. It will disturb and disrupt one's expectations. The performer themselves don't know what's going to happen. It is very much like that 8 seconds of hell when a guy or a girl gets on the back of a bull who has been inflicted with hunger and annoying girths, tightening, and all of that. They know they have to stand there 8 seconds. They know it's a bull. They've been there before. There's nothing common or ordinary about what's going to happen to them this time when they get on there, on that bull. And I remember Merce saying something to the effect that if you pay attention and you know so clearly what you're doing, and this is where I think I'm not sure if the human's capable of this. If you are so clearly articulate about your steps and your movements and your rhythms, and you are at the same time 110% present, it will be new each time.
That's how you keep it real.
And that's how you keep it real. I think that's in Merce's terms. In my terms, you do have the skill, you have practiced, but the forces are manufactured in such a way that they're flailing at you constantly, other forces, like either the floor is turning, or something's coming at you, or there's an edge to your space, or whatever, or you're strapped in a machine going really fast in a circle. And it's never normal. And I think that that ends up being the same, but different as an approach.
The influence on you of John Cage?
Well, John Cage once, well, it's the influence of John Cage on me is huge, continues to be huge. He was a big hero of mine. In fact, I was working in a restaurant on Bleecker Street called The Wild Mushroom, and as everyone knows, he was a famous mushroom expert. And he walked in and said, the restaurant was called, as I said, Wild Mushroom. And he walked in saying, are the mushrooms really wild? And I was a cook at the time. And I said, well, no, I don't think so. We got them at the AMP. And then he just turned around and walked out. And everyone was, oh my God, that was John Cage. And that was my first encounter with him. And then, I think that, his comments such as, I mean, there was a piece done about him, a on television called I Have Nothing to Say and I'm Saying It. He and Merce had come to my show at DTW in 1981, and at the end of the show, there was a knock on our dressing room. I was there with Michael Schwartz, and we opened the door, and it was Merce Cunningham and John Cage. And still to this day, I have to pinch myself to believe that that actually happened to me. And I was nobody. It was my first show. Why were they there? We didn't know, but they really liked the show, and they were complimentary. You live in New York. And then they left, and from then on, it was just complete love. Because I asked him to write this letter for me to put in my press kit, because I was just getting started, you know, and I asked them a lot of things, and they never said no. Like, will you recommend me for a Guggenheim? But this, for the beginning of the letter he wrote for me was, I find the art of dance disgusting for personal, political, and physical reasons. But anytime I hear that Elizabeth is performing, I go to see her work. And the question is, you know, was that helpful, you know, to put the art of dance is, I find it disgusting. But I thought he was a holy man. I thought that his ineffable approach to how he thought about work and the ephemeralness of work, the idea that this was a practice, a life practice, and that it included for him music, of course, sound, but movement and behavior. There was no separation between his life and his work. But his thought process was so advanced that I'm still struggling to keep up with Cage in the way that he approached. I mean, I think I'm much more of a capitalist and much more of a pragmatist, and I wouldn't have the guts to, or the ability to be someone like John with my work, you know.
What do cooking and choreography have in common?
Well, cooking and choreography are very similar. It's all rhythm. It's all rhythm. If you miss a move in the kitchen when you're cooking for 150 people, your night is ruined. And the beauty is that how long does it take for chicken to cook? How long for fish to cook? How long for pasta to boil? And this was like, I felt like I was a maestro. I was like going, chicken, you know, putting in, getting out perfectly. There's only one perfect moment when you have to take the fish out. There's not 1,000 different moments. There's just one when the fish is perfect. And that, you know, when you're cooking something, you take it out, you know you have to wager into that moment, the fact that it's going to continue to cook till it gets to the person's table. And I adored it. It was really hard work, but I felt that it was really not that much different than creating temporal structures and physical spatial structures with the body.